sure Frederick didn't sit there scratching, oh yes, there's my descending hexachord, chromatic descending hexachord bass there. But it's in there. It's embedded in so much of this popular music. And that's kind of what we're going to track here a little bit. But we're going to start with the Baroque. So we could start with who's the best, or the, yeah, we could even say the best composer of the Baroque. Well, J.S. Bach. J.S. Bach. So let's start with an organ piece of Bach, and we'll listen to an ostinato bass. Generally speaking in music, when you get an ostinato, it's applied to the bass. It sets up a repeating harmony. So that's what we got here. So here's a Passacaglia, just a little bit of it by Bach. See what he's doing once he gets his bass in there, and it's a typical 8-bar pattern. It's odd how many of these ostinato basses are in 8-bar units. So it's an 8-bar pattern here. Then all he does is keep throwing over top of that different rhythmic patterns and slightly different melodic patterns as well. But that bass, ya dee ka tum ba dee ka tum ba dee 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 tum, churning away. Over and over underneath in that piece for what instrument by Bach? Organ, big, powerful pipe organ, wonderful, wonderful sound. All right, so that's an introduction to the basso ostinato, or the ostinato bass by Bach. Let's turn to some music now of Henry Purcell. Henry Purcell was an English composer working in London at the end of the 17th century. He was employed by must have been James II, and then I think William and Mary for a little bit. So he wrote for the court, and he also wrote for the theater. And in one instance, that turned out to be his most famous composition, he wrote an opera for an all-girls boarding school in the London suburb of Chelsea. I guess it's now part of downtown London. There's a famous soccer team, Chelsea something, I don't know, you see them on TV. So there's Henry Purcell out at this all-girl boarding school, and annually they put on a drama. So it was kind of like a senior class play, and all the roles were sung by women, except in this case, one role was sung by a male, and that was the role of Aeneas. So we've got the famous story of Dido and Aeneas.
The job is rugged.
In music classes, you've probably read it possibly in Latin.
Да. Алло.
Привет.
Да-да.
Привет, звонил.
Да, привет, звонил. Сейчас, секунду, подожди, что-то у меня. Звук включу сейчас.
Как у тебя дела?
Дела хорошо, нормально, Саша, дела.
Все хорошо, я чувствую голос бодрый, значит, что-то получается, да?
Ну, как бы, тихонько, тихо просто, тихо. Да.
Понятно, все, ты с Авичкой-то созваниваешься, что-то я давно не звонила, я вся в таких этих тут туда-сюда бегаем, до туда-сюда, так я что-то ей не звонила в последнее время, завтра вот я посвободнее, наверное, завтра позвоню.
Звони иногда, звони, да.
Нормально, все хорошо у нее, да?
Ну, не знаю, вроде была так нормально, да.
Угу. Угу. Ну, очень даже замечательно, я рада.
Ага. Ладно, ты... Ты как?
Что?
Все нормально?
Да нормально, потихоньку. Просто у меня сейчас не бывает времени в городе, так как тебе бы заехать. Просто я, видишь, если я в городе, то я до вечера, до позднего.
А, ладно.
Вот, да, нет, просто ты-то ко мне ведь никак не приезжаешь, как тебя не зовешь.
Да, тут свои мне некогда.
Некогда, да? Mm-hmm. Ну ты просто так звонил?
Ну вообще просто, да, в целом так.
Я не слышала просто, да.
Ага. Ну ты приезжай там иногда сейчас, заходи, приезжай, в смысле там. Вообще.
Ладно. Буду приезжать. Ладно, давай, сын, спокойной ночи.
Ну ладно, не болей, давай, не хворай.
Да, ты звони, давай. Ладно, я приеду, как только будет возможность. Ладно? Ну,
давай, пока.
Давай, пока.
Да, она приходит сейчас, да, это на этой месте. Смотри, туда ехать, это полдня, понимаешь? Ну, даже не суть разговора, зачем? Какой-то, да. Я на работе, работаю. Телефон все выше здесь.
Traditional classical Latin, where the syntax is radically different than medieval Latin or any kind of modern language. Okay, well, good for you guys. So you know the story. Somebody tell me the story then. Michael, what's the story? So Aeneas has to leave for another country. It happens to be what country? Yeah, he's got to follow his destiny and go off and found the city of Rome in the vernacular, having ditched Dido back in Carthage. She's not happy about this. She dies, depending upon the theatrical version or the original. She either stabs herself, falls on a burning funeral pyre, or dies of a broken heart. But this is opera. So you know that at the end of it, the soprano's got to die, right? This is the way operas die. Operas end, die, dead. So anyway, you could do Violetta and Traviata. You could do Tosca and Tosca. We've even seen here the Liebestod at the end of Wagner's Tristan. Isolde dies after seeing the Liebestod expire. So it's a convention of opera. And in this particular opera, we have a famous aria. It's called Dido's Lament, where she is lamenting the fact that she has been abandoned by Aeneas. And it's interesting because it's built on an ostinato bass line. And it's built on an ostinato bass line that descends. And this is important because it became a convention for lamentation. So this is the bass line for Dido's lament here. And it just keeps cycling over and over again. That's the ostinato. And then up above that, we have the lamentation.
Ой, вот это вот что такое?
No trouble in my breast. Remember me, but I'll forget my fate. So that's what she's singing. So let's listen to a bit of this. And before we do that, we have the term on the board up there, ground bass. All that is the English term for ostinato bass. Ground bass, ostinato bass, the same thing. But it gives us the sense, at least, that the bass grounds. It kind of holds together. It's the foundation for the entire composition. So let's listen. We'll start with the ground bass.
Все хорошо.
Here, Linda, please, and
что
then
вы хотите?
Что
ты от меня хотел? Вот это и есть на самом деле. Ну, как сказал, жить заново дают. Ну как ты? Ну да.
Okay, let's stop it there. So that's how this plays out, and that bass keeps cycling through the
duration
of this particular aria. Listening to this recording gives us the opportunity to think about approaches to music. This is
at
the end of the 17th century. And actually, in this particular recording, they're playing this and singing in a way that would be rather similar to the way they would have done it in the 17th century. They have reproduction of 17th century instruments. And the singer here is trying to create a particular approach vocally to the music. So as we listen to this recording one more time, we're going to hear just a little bit more of it, and then we're going to ask you to compare this recording to another recording. This would be the kind of thing that a reviewer would do. So let's listen to a bit more of this recording A, we'll call it, and then we'll move on. Now we're going to go on to recording B. So what's the difference here in approach, in terms of orchestra, everything, voice, and how does recording B differ from recording A?
No, I don't speak with you. I'm not looking at you.
Singer had a much more youthful approach, and you could see that as an attempt to maybe duplicate the performance context of the original performance in a high school, a girls' school there in late 17th century. More specifically, what about the quality of that voice? Any thoughts? Roger? Okay, now, so we have the two recordings. Which of the two had more vibrato, one or two? Two had a lot more vibrato. So that's really the big difference here, that one was a very well-focused voice with very little vibrato, and maybe that's what gave it this youthful appeal. It's almost like the voice of a choir boy, or a choir girl, for heaven's sake. A pre-adolescent child, but intending to make it very pure and very, very clean and very well focused. The second recording, that might be a recording that you would expect to hear, a performance you would expect to hear where? Maybe in a modern opera theater or an opera hall, a hall designed for opera, where we've got this huge expanse that we have to fill.
What about the orchestra? Frederick? No, the Easton's thing.
You mean higher in terms of pitch? Frederick, you have a very good ear. Actually, that's true. I don't want to get into this, but the first recording is pitched in F sharp in your Baroque tuning. They're trying to really be so authentic. Pitch in the Baroque era was actually lower than it is today. We know that because they're tuning forks that survived in that period. They got labeled on an A. You play that A, and it turns out to be our G sharp. So aficionados of this particular repertoire, when they go to perform Baroque music, they're going to use reproductions of authentic instruments, they're going to use non-vibrato singing, and they're going to use the lower pitch. I didn't plan on getting into that, but since you picked up on it, No, we don't have to do that. And to be honest with you, the only reason I remember that was I went to duplicate it before coming in here. I went to duplicate those pictures on the piano so I'd be up to speed with this. And I realized, Jesus, I have to do this in F sharp, and that's going to require some quick transposition up here because I can do it quickly in G with only two flats, but F sharp, well, I'm in sharp, so I've got to have to figure all of this out. So, but that is going on there. That's an interesting development. Anything else? What about the tempo? Size of the orchestra always determines to some degree the tempo. Oscar? Yeah, the second recording was much slower. I was intentionally trying to beat it up here, and it was a very labored beat pattern. It was much slower because they had many more instruments, a lot more people playing.
Many more instruments, more
people. The longer it takes for sound to clear, the slower your tempo will go, unless you're dramatically so it leads to the more people, the slower the tempo is going to go. So what we have here is a reproduction of an attempt to reproduce authentic 17th century performance as opposed to a modern performance, big sound, metropolitan opera type of sound. All right. Let's move on here. One interesting aspect of this, I discovered this driving down Whitney Avenue. This is true. Driving down Whitney Avenue one day, I must have been fishing for 91.5 on my FM dial and suddenly had a seizure or something and I didn't quite make it and I was listening to Elton John. Okay, listening to Elton John and what did I hear but the craziest thing? What I heard was this text. It's sad, it's sad, it's a sad, sad situation. And then I heard yum ding da dee da dee da dee hum. Whoa, wait a minute there. That's the personal bass line. That's the personal bass line. Elton John has stolen the personal bass line. Arrest that man. No, we don't do this because, as we say, these bass lines are in the common domain. As we just said before, you can't sue anybody for the theft of a bass line. And indeed, it was all over the place in the Baroque. This is a type of, it became a kind of musical icon. Anytime an audience would hear. They would think death or bad news. And actually, we still do today. Isn't it the Road Jack based on that same kind of ostinato. But in the Baroque, you could go back to Monteverdi's Lamenta della Ninfa. You could go to Bach's Cantata, Weinen, Klagen, Sorgen, Sagen. Elton John. So what Elton John was to take this, not the beginning of this piece, sorry is the saddest, or sorry is the hardest word to say. Yeah. He didn't use it at the beginning, he used it in the chorus. So here we are in the chorus of Elton John's, I think it's sorry is the saddest word to say.
Силки. Вики.
So that's just one example of the use of that particular octave. We have to call that a lament bass. Mozart even did it. He wrote a violin sonata on the occasion of his mother's death in E minor, and he has that thing just going down, descending. Basically, it's this descending tetrachord here that gets filled in. All right, so we've got that as an ostinato bass. What's the most famous ostinato bass of all time, Baroque or modern? The Pachelbel bass, okay? And we've got this thing called the Pachelbel canon. Do you have the Xerox for today? What's the Pachelbel canon? Well, we worked a little bit with this. I think it was listening exercise 8, I believe, early on in the course, where we were trying to have you focus on changing harmonies. And these harmonies are just generated by this repeating bass line. There's an irony with the Pachelbel canon, and that is that you never hear the canon in the Pachelbel canon. Why is that the case? It's because if you look, he's got these three canonic lines, the three staves above, all in the same register. And when people record this, they always do it with the same instrument, usually just with the violin. So we have the violins up above, three violins all playing in the same register. You can't pick out the canon. It just sounds like this unfolding jumble. It's a very beautiful jumble, but it's indistinctive in that sense. Maybe if they orchestrated oboe, flute, and clarinet, maybe we could hear the canon better. What we hear, of course, grinding away underneath, is the ostinato bass. So let's listen to just a bit of this. And I was struck the other day when I went back and listened to this recording on your CDs, they have put in this something that's actually Pachelbel didn't write. When this starts out, they just start with a... What's that? It's a descending major scale. So they just say, all right, here's your basic tonality, here's your tonal grid or whatever. So let's listen to the bass start out, then we'll have this descending scale that Pachelbel didn't write, and then his canon will start. And you can see how this works here. I've indicated A gets repeated as B comes in, and so on. It's pretty straightforward how the canon operates. Something new.
Наоборот, она посекон.
But you know this bass, right? Okay, so there's our D. Let's all sing it together. Ready, sing. Da, da, da. You get that in your ear, you have a sense it's really in there, and that you may have heard that many different times before. Now, lots of people made use of the Pachelbel canon, and I know of at least three and maybe four that I put up on the board up there, and you may know of more. Marcos sent me a clip of a comedian. Maybe you guys have seen this. What's the comedian's name? Just make sort of so sick of the Pachelbel canon because every piece he picks up has got the bass line of the Pachelbel canon. What comedian was that? Doesn't matter. Okay. So those are my four. Anybody else know where else they show up? All right, well, let's review. Thaddeus, good. Britney Spears has the Pachelbel canon? What?
12, всего лишь 12.
All right. Thaddeus, go get that for me. I need this one. This is gold. Thank you very much. But check it. For example, one of the students, Daniel in here, sent me, gave me, and we talked about it. Let's go to that one. It would be CD4 track.
Ну, наоборот, затратил голову, только понял.
He said, this may be a knockoff of the Pachelbel canon. It's called the Taco Bell canon. So let's see if the Pachelbel canon is in fact embedded in the Taco Bell singing, yes or no? I mean, think yes, raise your right hand. I mean, think no, raise your left hand. No, it ain't the Pachelbel canon. Is it an ostinato bass? Yes, it's an ostinato bass. We could keep playing with that. I could play you Coolio, the Blues Traveler, Vitamin C, just for a laugh. Let's do Vitamin C, which is CD 2, track 1. And I'm sorry about this, but it's too good to pass up. Okay, so out you go. Thanks for your attention. Appropriately enough, it's in the key of C. Vitamin C, C.
Запрещено, запрещено все. Вот это есть там самый. Да.
Geologists occasionally will say this particular crystal has a fugue-like structure to it, turning to painting. There are painters of the 20th century. I can name at least three, Franz Kupka, Henri Valence, and Joseph Albers, who used to be the dean of our own School of Art and Architecture. They all painted fugues, and we will be looking at Albers' fugue, which actually happens to be in your textbook, when we come to section this week. So be sure to bring your textbooks to section this week because we will be using them. I'm interested in the fugue also because of this book, Douglas Hofstadter's Gödel, Escher, Bach. Oh my, it's heavy. I didn't bring in my copy. This is the Bass copy that Linda was kind enough to pull over. Mine is a paperback. It's not this heavy. But in a way, this is indicative because it's heavy reading. Anybody ever peeked at this book and any other? Is it Adam? Yeah, Adam. What course did you read this in? I'm recommended by friends. I can follow about the first 25 or 30 pages or so. Then when it gets to the math, it really gets over my head. But what it is an attempt to use the fugue as a way of bringing a common mode of understanding to the visual arts, to mathematics, and to music. The musician that is foreground here, of course, is J.S. Bach, the master of the fugue. So we want to know about how fuse operates. So let's take a look at the specifics here. The term fuse actually comes from an old Latin word, fuga, which means flight, or to fly. So in a fuge, what you get is one voice going ahead, leading ahead, and another voice following it. Now, I just used the term voice there. Fugues can be written for actual voices, sounding voices, or they can be written for instruments such as the violin or the cello, individual lines. They can even be written for instruments that can play